You want to support Roland Martin Unfiltered? Be sure to join our Bring the Funk fan club. Every dollar that you give to us supports our daily digital show. Go to RolandMartinUnfiltered.com.
This way, Politico had a story this week. And this is what they said in their story, quote, meanwhile, the white vote is increasingly coalescing around the Republican Party in the Trump era, leading to a racially divided political system. Florida's Democratic Party is now majority non-white, while the Republican Party of Florida, compared with Florida's general population demographics, is disproportionately white. The racial realignment of the parties may be disadvantaging the Democratic Party, which increasingly relies on voters with low turnout rates, while the most reliable voting demographic turns towards the GOP. Republicans often talk about Party of Lincoln, talk about what took place with the Voting Rights Act, the Civil Rights Act, yet the Republican Party today has a problem with black people and getting them to vote for them, but even appealing to them.
I agree. I think that's unfortunate. I think it is unfortunate that the racial polarization in the country is reflected in the racial polarization between the parties. Now, this does in no way prove that the Republicans have departed from the principles of Lincoln. Remember, Lincoln also got the white vote. In other words, Lincoln was accused of being the white man's president.
Well, first of all, black people couldn't vote, so obviously he got the white vote.
Well, black people could vote in the North.
Well, a few could, but my point is, overall, he was running for president of the United States. You're going to have to depend upon a white vote to win.
That's absolutely right. But I mean, Frederick Douglass at one point said Lincoln was the white man's president. So what I'm getting at is this. You know, I think there has been an unfortunate. The question is, what is causing this polarization? I don't think it's all Trump. You have to admit that the polarization goes much earlier.
Oh, no. The polarization actually goes back to August of 1619. The reality is that has been the country that we've been. The issue has been a Republican Party that played a critical role in, for so long, being able to get black votes. And if you were black, you didn't even think about the Democratic Party, but the party has essentially walked away from black folks since 64. That's where it really started, that split.
Well, let's explore this a little further. Let's start with the white vote. You would agree that FDR won the white vote, right? The working class white vote went for the Democrats in the 30s
and 40s. Again, same thing.
Okay.
First of all, prior to anything before the Voting Rights Act is the white vote, because for the most part, black people were still disenfranchised across the country.
No, here's my point. It's not white versus black. It is that working class whites were Democrats rather than Republicans. Would you agree in the FDR era? Okay. What I'm saying is that the Democratic Party began to alienate those voters, not just on cultural or racial issues, but also economically. It allowed globalization to wipe away their jobs and paid very little attention to that important demographic change. So here's what I'm getting at. Trump was shrewd enough to recognize this and appeal to those voters, but his appeal wasn't a racial appeal. His appeal was a jobs appeal. So if working class guys who used to identify with the Democratic Party because their jobs were secure through unions now identify because they think Trump cares more about them than the Democrats, that's not a racial change.
Well, he was actually making a racial appeal. So for him, even go back further than that. Because if you talk about what took place with unions, you had a Republican Party that really went, especially if you look at Ronald Reagan and going forward, was in many ways going after unions in different ways. It all depends on what unions we're talking about. Trade unions maintain more of an alliance with Republicans, but because the unions became more service-oriented, that's why you saw more black and brown people, and so you had a split. Republicans love police unions. They don't like other types of unions. So it depends upon the kind of union we're talking about that appeals to the Republican Party.
But in fairness, first of all, Reagan was a union guy from the Screen Actors Guild. Second of all, Republicans are ideologically against the idea of the kind of government protections that unions demand. That's an ideological point. It's not a racial point. Republicans are happy to enforce that point neutrally, whether it's a white, predominantly white union or predominantly black union. So you can't take conservatives and take our ideological position like small government and accuse those of being disguised arguments for race, because that is consistent with an ideology that we apply across the board.
Well, there are different types of Republicans, if we want to be honest, and different types of conservatives, because there are individuals. I take Texas. For the longest, Texas had, for everybody who was elected in Texas, statewide, they were Democrats. That was a different type of conservative. But there's a difference between folks who have been democratically conservative and Republicans who have been conservative. One of the issues that we still also within the Republican Party, you have different Republicans. You have those who some call national security Republicans, others call economic Republicans, others who call social conservatives. And then you have those who might call themselves, as being moderate. The issue to me today.
But look at all the. You named four categories, and none of those categories are predominantly racial at all. So let's take the national security guys. They're against ISIS. They want a strong America. They're not against Muslims. They would be against Russians if the Russians did the same thing that ISIS did. Second of all, the economic conservatives are all about small government. The social conservatives came mainly about issues like abortion. So what I'm getting at is you see a party that's not defined racially, but nevertheless has a constant effort to pin the racial tail on the Republican donkey, though that's not what motivates us.
But here's the piece. But it is there. I mean, the fact of the matter is, I'll give you a perfect example. When I had the show Washington Watch on TV One, we offered blanket invitation to any member of the Republican conference to come on the show. Anyone, at any time. Virtually no response. And in fact, they called Sean Connor, who was an African-American at the RNC, hey, what do you think? And Sean said, y'all should go on the show. If you want an opportunity to talk to black people, this is the only television show that's a Sunday morning news show. Wouldn't do it. Tom Price came on. Pete Olson came on. Tom Price came on twice. Olson came on. When Alan West came on, I told Alan West the same thing. Alan West told his press secretary, he said, send an email right now to every press secretary in the Republican conference, and they should come to the Roland Martin show. He said he will give them a fair hearing and opportunity for them to talk about these issues. No response. And I keep saying to Republicans, you can't go on one hand, why are black folks voting Democrat when you have Republicans who make no effort to even go after black people because there's this fear of what are the issues that are going to come up?
The Republicans, and I think Trump is in a different category here, but generally Republicans are scared of the race issue. And they're scared that they will be accused of racism and they will not know how to respond.
How about you respond based upon issues?
I couldn't agree more.
But part of it being scared is because they have to deal with the realities also of policy. So for instance, on this show, we talk about the issue of voter suppression constantly. Republicans come, oh, no, it doesn't exist. And I'm going, we're looking at it. When I bring up North Carolina, when the federal court said there was a laser-like targeting of black voters, Colin Powell, when he went to North Carolina, criticized Governor McCrory in his face and saying what you are doing when it comes to voting in this state is wrong and it's not fair to black people. And folks said, okay, whatever the hell, we don't listen to Colin Powell. He was a Republican, a black Republican trying to tell them that. And I'm telling you right now, for black people, Trump can run around and talk about jobs all day. He can talk about all the other different issues. But for black people, there's nothing more fundamental than when efforts are put in place to deny them the opportunity to vote.
Look, here's what I was getting at when I said that Republicans have this kind of fear. Just a few days ago, I spoke on a college campus, and somebody asked me a question about LBJ. And they were asking me about LBJ's supposed conversion from being a racist Democrat to a morally enlightened progressive. And I said, in my opinion, this conversion was highly suspect because there was very strong evidence that well into the 60s, in fact, post the 1964 Civil Rights Act, Johnson was regularly using the N-word. And I cited Robert Carroll, I cited Doris Kearns Goodwin, I cited Barbara Dalek.
Yeah, we got it.
Okay, so the moment I said that, there were on a number of left-wing websites, Dinesh uses the N-word. And I'm like, I use the N-word. I'm actually accusing LBJ of speaking like that and quoting him and citing the historians who have pointed this out. But see, my point is, because I'm not a white guy, that attack doesn't stick. But if it was a white guy, he would freeze because it'd be like, oh, I use the N-word. Even though the left does this kind of hit on you. Even though it's a smear, it's completely unfair. I'm not saying you're doing it, but I'm saying Republicans live in fear that when they're accused of using the N-word and it's some white guy, he doesn't know what to say. And his career may be over because of so that's why they say, let's stay away.
First of all, you don't have to even use the N-word. You can simply say, LBJ, use the N-word. You don't have to actually use the word. I mean, so first of all, if you're white, all you have to say is, folks, here's evidence where LBJ used the N-word. Nobody's going to get mad because you said the N-word. You're probably going to get a little bit mad if you actually use the word. But here's the issue even with that. even with that, Republicans bring that up, but there's no denying where LBJ was on driving through those policies, how they're going to impact black people.
Of course, now, the argument
first
is
of all, first of all, there were a whole bunch of white folks who used the N-word because that was just a common thing for them. But I can still look at when, if you look at, again, Civil Rights Act, Voting Rights Act, Fair Housing Act, there was no greater politician during that period who said, we're going to make this thing happen, even over the objections of his fellow Southern Democrats.
Well, LBJ made a calculation that the demographics were changing, that there was a great black migration, blacks were voting in much greater numbers. Also, the white vote was already moving toward the Republican Party in the 50s. In any event, I'm not disagreeing that LBJ pushed the Civil Rights Act. I'm questioning what his motivation was. I think it was tactical. I think he was looking at the long-term interests of the Democratic Party.
But Abraham Lincoln was tactical.
Of course it was.
I mean, you have evidence. I mean, Abraham Lincoln literally said, if I can save the Union, if I can save the Union and slavery exists, fine. If I can save the Union and then get rid of slavery, fine. My goal is to save the Union. There's documented evidence of LBJ's feelings about black people, about slaves. And so there's always that motivation for a politician. Still, the question is the end result of what they did. The reality is, with all the motivation of Lincoln, which, of course, Lerone Bennett laid out in his book Before the Mayflower and all those different issues about Lincoln, the reality is Lincoln still signed the Emancipation Proclamation, which freed the freed slaves in the territories that were involved in the Civil War. And then you had to still battle after that. And so you still had that issue. Same with LBJ. But the problem that I still see is this here, from a Republican Party. When I use the phrase, they're scared of black people, I'm telling you, black Republicans, who I've known all my life, it drives them crazy when their own party, they won't even listen to them. And they're sitting here going, guys, you will never get black people to listen to you if you're afraid to even walk into the room and sit and talk with them.
Hey fam, I want you to like, share, and subscribe to our YouTube channel, youtube.com/RolandSMartin. And don't forget to turn on your notifications. Martin.